giant voice.
The official podcast of the U.S. Navy's largest overseas installation, Commander Fleet Activities Yokosuka. This is the Giant Voice Podcast.
Welcome, everybody, to another episode of the Giant Voice Podcast. We are back after something of a break here over summer. We've been very busy at the Fleet Activities Yokosuka Public Affairs Office, making a lot of video and cool stuff for everybody. But I think this is kind of a fitting return. Today, we're going to talk about back to school, getting kids back to school. What are some of the issues and challenges with getting kids back to school, and especially regarding the hull swap coming up and on-base school versus maybe some people in the States who were going to off-base school and are now going to be here in Japan. Just generally, everything you need to know about getting your kids back to school on base here. So I have two guests with me today. Ladies, if you would introduce yourself.
So my name is Ruth-Ann Hadjis-Vickory, and I am an occupational therapist with Readiness out of Yokota. So I made the trip all the way to Yokosuka today.
Nice.
Hi, my name is Rowana Reyes. I'm also an occupational therapist, and I'm based here in Yokosuka. EDI is Yokosuka.
Awesome. So tell me about a little bit about real quick. What does an occupational therapist do?
Yeah, so a really simple way of putting it is that we help people do the things that they need to do in a day and want to do in a day. So being able to take care of themselves and being able to fulfill the obligations they have at their work or in a child's case, school.
Mm-hmm. Got it.
So basically, as the term says, occupational therapists, we all have occupations, right? So a job. So for the students, their occupation is being a student, going to school. So we help them in those areas of need through their daily routines and like self-care. You know, you need to be able to take care of yourself when you go to school.
So cool. So we're going to talk about lots of stuff. I really like the definitions you guys gave, and especially in a student's case, like, yeah, that's their job. And if they're having problems, you know, what do we do to help? So, yeah, the school year is coming up quickly. They start when? End of August?
August 19th.
August 19th.
Wow, that seems so early. Yeah. I feel like when I was a kid, it wasn't like that, right?
Like after Labor Day.
Yeah, exactly. 100%.
Right.
But okay, so August 19th. So here's my memories, right, of being a kid. Is that kind of like, to use like a weird word, like that ennui of like school is coming, like, yes. Oh no.
The
like,
anticipation.
Yeah. And my mom being like, getting that list of school yes. supplies and being like, oh my God, where are we going to get all this? So I imagine some people are maybe already spinning into that cycle if school's 20 days away or whatever mm-hmm. it is. So I guess that's why you guys are here, right? So let's talk about that. Like, what are you doing to prepare? How do they start shifting their routine into the school year routine, getting away from that summer freedom into more structure? What's some things that people can do?
Yeah, so I think you highlighted it really well, going from a very unstructured routine, right, where we're staying up a little bit later.
Right.
We maybe can come and go as we please. We're playing with our friends. To now I have to wake up early and mm-hmm. sit at a desk all day, right?
Right.
And that could be a pretty drastic change for people. So chaining is a really, really easy way to start introducing a new routine. So what I mean is, don't try to have your kids wake up right at school time. If they've been waking up at 9 or 10, it's going to be really hard if you're like 6:30 one day. Like,
on one day.
Hey, we got to get up. We got to get on the bus, or we got to walk to school. So slowly building to that point. So maybe, you know, that first day trying to get them up, you know, at 9 instead. Do that for a couple days, then maybe wake them up at 8. But doing that a couple weeks prior to school starting, so that way we're getting in that routine of mm-hmm. getting up and getting used to, like, I have to be out the door at this time.
Right. Rather than just springing it. Mm-hmm. I mean, even for a lot of adults, that's a hard ask
yes.
to go, I got to mm-hmm. change my wake-up routine, right?
And summer really is a fun time because we're talking about almost 2 months, right?
Right.
So routines and sleep cycles have changed. Diets have changed. Time with their friends, gaming especially.
Of course.
So really, it's a perfect time. I would say 2 weeks before, and then get that alarm clock, like what Ruth-Ann said, prepare them. Okay, slowly chaining the time. Because here at Sullivan's in Yokosuka, we start like 7:30, 7:45.
It's early.
So think about if you've been used to waking up at 9 or 10, because it's summer, you need to chain that, especially if you have to ride the bus. Once you miss that bus stop, mommy needs to drop you off. So a lot of things. And then not only that, their friends. They're anticipating some friends that have PCS. Are they here? Are they? Who is going to be my classmate? What's my section? You know, especially for the older kids. And then, what to expect? Who's my teacher? Do I know my teacher? And then, most importantly, is you know how kids nowadays with the social media. Okay, what am I going to wear? What are my shoes? What are my fun stuff for pencils and all of that? So I think with that we can control. Because I know parents have already looked at the exchange for the list of supplies. So there's something maybe make them accountable. Okay, which notebook do you want according to this? What color pencil? So it gives them control as well.
Mm.
And then they'll be like, I'm ready to be a student. And that's their occupation.
So that's great information. I remember when my son was younger, reading something about, like, try to give them structured choices, mm-hmm. like in the mm-hmm. morning, like you can wear this or this, right?
Yes.
And that allows them like some kind of control over without giving them total, you know, because what do they call that? Like if you have every choice available, you make no choice, right? And so is that like a viable thing?
Yeah, exactly. So we want to give our kids autonomy where we can, right? But also... we don't want them to spend forever making that choice and be mm-hmm. late.
Right.
So narrowing it down and letting them pick it out the night before. So
yes,
the night before prep is essential, because in the morning things are going to come up. You might wake up late. Siblings might be bickering. Things just happen. So doing things the night before and having those choices, because then also the morning of, we're not trying to pick what to wear or what mm-hmm. to eat or what to pack in our lunch. We can prepare those things so when we wake up the next morning, we're ready to go and we have a little less on our plate mm-hmm. that we have to handle. The other thing with clothing, too, is for our kids that have sensory stuff going on. So maybe like tags don't feel good one day or certain textures.
Yep.
Having two or three choices that they pick out the night before will make it so that way if something doesn't feel good, you have some backup options too.
Mm-hmm.
And that can help with some of those, what we call like those meltdowns in the morning too.
It's funny because like we do this when I was a kid, I'm sure you guys too. I remember school that morning being stressful, right?
Yes.
And you know, as an adult, there's a tendency to go like, it's not a big deal. But it is a big deal to the kid. We have to put ourselves back in that time and go like, this is a stressful thing. Like which green t-shirt I'm going to wear today, right?
Yes.
And we're building those like habit patterns, right? Mm-hmm. So we take that for granted as an adult because we just do it, right? But kids, that's how they're learning how to be independent. And so like supporting them through that and having patience and setting them up for success is key. The other thing too is just knowing where your kid is at. So they might not be ready to be independent, but maybe there's a stepping stone. Like maybe we could do a visual checklist with like a picture of the things that they need mm-hmm. to do. So that way we're supporting them in that independence, but, you know, not setting them off to sea, hoping that they're going to find their way back to shore,
That doesn't work, definitely. Well, so my son goes to Japanese school, mm-hmm. like we said, and the kids walk by themselves once they hit elementary school. But he's on the younger side for his grade, and he just wasn't really ready. He wasn't comfortable with it. And, you know, they have guards. It's not... This thing that they're just off on themselves. The school has kind of routes mm-hmm. that are designated and people post along the way, but he still wasn't ready. And so my wife, who teleworks some days, would walk him about halfway in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
And I think she did a really good job, like what you said, of only pushing him as far as she thought he could handle. And guess what? After a while, he said to her, I want to walk by myself, right? He.
And that's the chaining.
Perfect example. Yeah. Look at that.
Good, see?
Because it's all about, initially it was codependency and then attachment to parents. Of course, there's that safety net. is mommy behind me? Hey, I'm still here. And then as you increase the distance, there's the chaining. And he knows he's safe. He sees his teachers and classmates. And says,
right.
It's okay, mom. I can do it.
That's what he did. It was very cool. Uh-huh. You know, on that topic, like getting your kid, you know, the chaining you're talking about and getting your kid comfortable with school. I think you had mentioned something about open house or something like that. Why don't you tell me a little bit more about that?
So different schools, I mean, at least for here in Yokosuka, Sullivan's, Ikego, and the new Yokosuka Primary School, which is the universal pre-K to first grade, they have a scheduled open house. And this is a perfect opportunity for the students, the children, to go visit the classroom. What does it look like? Especially for the new enrollees and the parents to see what's going on. There'll be teachers and, like, get to visit, get to meet the principal and everyone. So, I mean, it's an open house for everyone, and I think parents should avail of it because it eases that tension as opposed to just starting on the first day of school, like, what am I doing? And also they get to see their friends from last year.
Yeah, perfect. Yeah, I think, like you said, it's like, you're introducing things little by little, making like starting in the shallow end and getting into the deep end, right? So cool. And then on that topic, like if we go into the school year and kids are starting, so let's talk about, you know, some expectations, right? For kind of milestones or, like what they can do during the school year, kind of specifically for kids who are maybe new to school,
Yeah, so it's a big year for Dodeo, right? Because we are starting Universal Pre-K Japan-wide. And so there's going to be a lot of kids that are going to have their first school experience.
Wow, yeah.
Yeah, so there's a lot with school, right, that we take for granted as adults, like being able to go to a new place, spend the entire day there, listen, follow instructions, take care of yourself, and do the schoolwork. That's a lot going on, right? And some areas that parents can focus on are, so a child's adaptive skill. So that's their ability to help themselves. So if we're starting school, we want to be toilet trained. So if your kid's struggling with that, really reinforcing, you know, good toileting habits prior to school starting, being able to feed themselves, like open snack packaging, being able to open their lunchbox, being able to handle their school material. So we take for granted, like, just being able to carry a backpack and open it and put things in and take things out. But that's something you want to practice with your kid and make sure that they're comfortable with that.
Of course, yeah.
And then making sure, you know, that they're able to do some of those dressing skills, like, you know, taking their coat off, putting their cone on, pulling their pants down and up independently.
Shoes on and off.
Is huge. And so making sure that your child is able to take care of themselves. And if they're struggling in some of those areas, working on it prior to school starting and just letting their teacher know, like, hey, these are their strengths. Maybe these are some areas just to be on the lookout for, and letting your child know if they need help with that. Don't be afraid to ask a trusted adult to help you.
Right.
And that's very important because, yes, it's not only the independence in physically doing things, but also teaching your child to advocate for themselves, because this is a new world for them. It's very stressful and scary for some, but knowing, having that assurance that there's an adult in the room, a teacher, assistant teacher.
Somebody can help you.
Can help, a friend. So learning to, like, raise your hand if you need help, always ask.
Got it.
Yeah, and that kind of leads into some of our social, emotional, and, like, communication skills that we should have. So, you know, being able to advocate for yourself and being able to communicate with others, being able to share with other children is a huge thing.
Yeah, especially only children can have a real tough time with that stuff.
Yes, and it could be a big learning curve sometimes, that first initial year of school. Something else that's super important for kids is listening skills. So being able to follow multiple step directions, right?
Right.
Again, things that we don't think about, but if a teacher says, okay, go grab, you know, your coat and go grab your snack because we're going to lunch, right? Being able to follow those directions is really important. So working on that at home too, it could be as simple as you could say, all right, like, we're going to go to the library. Go ahead and put on your shoes and grab that book that we need to turn in. So that way you're preparing them for having to listen to instructions.
Multi-step instructions.
Because that's just something that, you know, we take for granted for just being able to listen and, you know, do whatever someone's asking of us.
Right. So sometimes we, I think, forget as parents, like, they don't know anything. Like, we have to teach them. There's a lot of stuff that we just do naturally that they have to be taught to do. Like, it's not just going to magically happen, you know?
Yeah.
Multi-step directions. That's a good thing to think about, I think.
And our attention span, too, right? So we have to build that. And I think especially nowadays with, like, instant gratification and, you know, reels and iPads and how quick we consume media, that could be a challenging thing. But it could be as simple as just working on, like, carpet time with your kids.
Sure.
So, like, having them, you know, sit and listen to a story for a certain period of time.
Yep.
Or, like, even getting, like, you know, a dance video off of some sort of social media or the internet and having them, you know, watch and participate in that.
Right.
So it doesn't necessarily have to be, like, academically based, but just working on that, attending to a task and participating in a group is really important.
Yeah, and watching something not just for the sake of watching it, but to, like, do something.
Engage.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then something as OTs that we focus on a lot are those motor skills, right? And all, like, the little things we have to do with our hands in order to do academic tasks, things like coloring and cutting.
Right.
And so, you know, getting your kid comfortable with markers and crayons before they start school is really important. Scissors, I know, are a scary, scary thing for parents. And I can't tell you how many kids that I've met that going to school is their first time ever being around scissors. But if you could just do some gentle introductions, so having them cut, like, Play-Doh
scissors.
Or little strips of paper. If scissors are too scary for you, I totally understand. You could do things like tearing paper so they're still having to work using both of their hands. But having that introduction prior to school will make it a little less scary for your kid, too.
Right. You don't, I think, I can remember that fear of, you know, okay, everybody do this thing, and me being the one who doesn't know how to do it, right?
Oh, no.
So I see what you're saying. Like, you help reduce stress by, like, just making sure that kids have the kind of skills that they're going to need to get through the basic steps of school, right?
Right, right. Mm-hmm. And it's not really the expectation. Like, if you, and I'm guilty as a parent, if you look at the milestone list when you go to the pediatrician's office, by age 3, the child should be able to do Bamba XYZ. And then a parent would read that, oh my God, my child is not doing this.
Right.
But we need to understand children go develop in their own pace.
Right.
It means, oh, maybe your child's skill is at the 4 to 5 year old level and some on the 3 year old level.
Right.
That's a win-win situation. Some parents put pressure on, my kid has not done this. And then they start of comparing their children with other children. So,
right.
I mean, it is not bad, but of course, at the end of the day, we have to understand that children are unique. They go at their own pace as long as they're learning, they're safe, and having fun.
Exactly.
Yeah. Meeting your child where they're at
is
the most important thing. And if you continue to meet them where they're at,
numbers. It's just numbers.
they're gonna get to where they need to be most of the time.
That's right.
Yeah.
I thought too, like, those milestones, like the ones in all the pediatric guides, like, they're guides more than anything else, aren't they? And I even remember reading, like, you only should talk to your doctor if it's multiple kind of going on at once and or whatever, right? Mm-hmm. And kids develop at their own pace.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And new studies have proven that.
Yeah. Yep. And I mean, I don't know. Are your kids bilingual? Did you raise them bilingual?
The first one, who is 25 years old, can speak Tagalog and English fluently.
Yep.
And then it trickled, like, the second one, who's 20 years old, like, can understand. And then the other one can listen. And I said, as long as you understand, so when you go to the Philippines, you're fine.
So, you'll get into trouble.
Yeah, yeah, right.
One thing, and I don't know your experience, but I was told this, and it turned out to be true, that kids who are raised bilingual, especially with one parent who's always speaking one language and one is speaking another, tend to be behind their peers in vocabulary, grammar, right? Because they have two sets of things that they're going on. So maybe that's right. Like if your kid isn't meeting a guideline, maybe it's because there's some other perfectly normal explanation going on, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And a lot of times, like with bilingual children, you know, you do see that delay, but eventually you're going to see like this expansive
explosion,
growth.
Right.
And it is so beneficial for their cognitive development, too.
Right.
And so sometimes it's like the end game,
yes,
right?
Like yes.
we're preparing for success later on, and they might be a little bit behind, but you're setting your child up for success.
Right.
Yeah.
Because the that's what they say is then like around high school, it's suddenly boom.
Yeah.
Right. And I mean, my son communicates great in English, but if you brought him to an English school as an 8-year-old, they would go, I mean, he's got 4-year-old English. What's going on here? Well, he goes to the only, he speaks English to me. That's it.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, yeah.
So, okay. So we talked a lot about the kind of pre-K, maybe elementary stuff. What about older kids? What about middle school, high school age kids?
Yeah, so middle school could be a big transition because we're going from typically having one or two teachers to then we have multiple teachers, right? It's the first
right.
time that we're really changing classes. We're moving to a new campus. So a lot of kids, it might be their first time being away from like their siblings or some of their friends at a different campus. And so you're really starting to turn up the heat on responsibility too. So kids are expected to keep track of their work and to come up with like creative ideas and stuff. That all starts in middle school. So for some kids, it's really exciting. Mm-hmm. But for some of our friends that really like routine and like that structure, it could be a little overwhelming.
Mm-hmm. Especially middle school it's a bigger school. And you're expected to function as a student that can navigate the hallways, the long hallways, find your locker.
Right.
Organization, put your backpack in the locker, take out your books within that 5 minute of class transition. So some of our friends who have some difficulty with that kind of transition, you know, will need help. However, being in a bigger environment with different teachers, you will have a lot of supports. And believe me, it is the most, it's like a rite of passage, like, oh, I'm in middle school now, sixth
yeah.
grade, yes. And like some of the students, like we see them in eighth grade, wow, you've made it. And then transitioning to high school,
yep.
then they get more excited being a freshman.
Do you think the transition from middle school to high school is easier?
I think in some ways, yes, because it's the same structure in regards mm-hmm. to, you know, you have
changing
multiple classes and
yeah.
stuff. You know, the big difference is obviously you're preparing for the outside world,
yes.
right?
So some form of career and anticipating a big change with leaving mom and dad.
Right.
Yeah, leaving your parents.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And escort is the, you know, high school is really, like what you said, preparing there for the real life skills. So there will be a choice of your electives, your classes. Are you planning to take AP classes for college and all those stuff? Sports, there you go. So the varsity, the junior varsity, clubs, so many things, social networks at the high school level. So many choices that you need to also focus on the academics. What are you really preparing for?
Right.
And then really the stability is good friendships.
Really,
yes, yes.
Yeah.
Staying out of trouble and, you know, following routines and schedules. I mean, they're in that tween stage, you know, not yet an adult.
Yeah.
Luckily, you know, here in Japan, I mean, here for the DIA, we have a really very nice small environment for the high school.
Yep.
Especially here in Yokosuka, you
yeah.
know.
I mean,
everything's walking distance.
Yeah, exactly.
Yes.
On that note, so we talked about prepping for the younger kids. What about prepping for high schoolers? Like, what are some of the things we're going to do to help them sort of transition?
Yeah, so a lot of the preparations for high school can also be applied to middle school, but it's giving them more responsibility. and letting them fly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so some ways that you can practice that, first of all, planners and organizational skills, right? That executive functioning of being able to plan out your day, plan out what assignments are due. So get your kid in the habit of writing things down or putting things in their phone or their computer planner, whatever is most comfortable for them, and having them take ownership of that. Now, that doesn't mean if they're a little younger or if organization skills, isn't their, you know, their strongest skill, not like it doesn't mean that you don't check in, but just giving them that opportunity to take ownership for their schedule. And so, you know, we only have a few more weeks left of summer, but an easy way to prep that is having them, you know, write down maybe some of the fun things that they're going to do, right? So, like, I'm going to hang out with my friends at the bowling alley, and having them keep track of that in an organized way. So that way, when it's time to do the serious stuff for school, they're ready to go.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Makes sense.
And also some of the planners, you know, I grew up with planners.
Yeah.
But now they're into apps.
Yep.
There's so many apps. I mean, Google Calendar is another one.
That will send you alerts.
Yep.
Yes. Yeah.
Yep.
Yes. And especially if they're involved in a lot of, as I've said, sports, clubs and everything, they need to be organized.
Yep.
What are the basic things? And then add on. You'll be amazed of their schedules. It's so full. I'm like, okay, can mommy have a schedule with you? You know? So, but it's important because that's how they build their strengths.
Yep.
And like really learning what they want to do with their life after high school.
Yeah.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. For sure. That's not easy. It's a lot of pressure in there to kind of go like, all right, I'm 17 years old. I got to try and figure out what the trajectory of my life is going to be. It's a lot. It's a lot.
Yes.
So, yeah, anything to alleviate a little bit of stress, like scheduling, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And then just like leaning into their interests, you know, like not, it doesn't have to be super high pressure, like, oh, this is what you're going to do for the rest of your life, but like really encouraging your children,
yes,
you know,
yes,
to do the things that they love and that they're passionate about, or, you know, pursue the things that they're super interested in. And then also letting them know, you know, this might be our plan senior year of high school, but you could live a million lives, right? And yep. So just having an initial game plan, but knowing that it can change and that's okay because that's life. So making your children adaptable, right?
Yep. And showing too, like I meet a lot of people, right? And I meet lots of people who they knew from high school that they wanted to be a doctor and that was it. They went on that trajectory. And then there's people like me who thought one thing was going to happen, something else happened, and I'm super happy and fulfilled in my life, but it definitely wasn't 17-year-old me's plan for my life.
Mm-hmm.
And both of those things are okay, right?
Right. And there comes the three letters, SAT, ACT, ASFAB, you know, all of those tests.
All the acronyms.
Okay.
All the letters.
Review.
Yep.
Okay.
So, we've talked now about the kind of like what we're doing to prepare. All right. But then let's say the school year starts and like, what if as a parent, I have concerns about how my child is adjusting to new school year, whatever the case might be.
So I think the first person that you need to really build a strong relationship with is your child's teacher or teachers. Right. And just letting them know what those concerns are, because they are there to support you and your child. And also your admin at your school. They can really be champions for your child and help if there is an area of need.
Mm-hmm. Right. And also the pediatricians or their PCMs. You can always talk to them if there are concerns on the academic level, developmental level.
Yep.
Because the hospital and the schools, we work together, you know, for overall development of the child. So that's good. The teachers and the PCMs, the doctors, the pediatricians as well.
And I think you mentioned earlier in the podcast, you know, like when we're talking about development, usually there isn't that concern unless there's like multiple areas, right?
Right.
And to let your kids develop, they're going to typically be just fine. But if you are in a situation where you are seeing multiple areas with their communication or their motor skills or their social emotional skills, that is really the time to reach out to their pediatrician. and they're going to be able to guide you through the process and get you to where you need to go.
Right. And a lot of times it's something that the pediatrician's going to know what's going on and going to have know exactly what needs to happen to get things back on track, right?
Yeah, and I think that a lot of times it could be a scary thing, right? But looking at it as we're going to get a game plan for how to address these areas, and we have so many resources in our community, that should hopefully alleviate some of that stress,
right?
That there are people here to help you. So one of those resources, EDIS, right?
Yep, you guys, yeah.
So EDIS, we work in kind of two major areas. So we do early intervention, so 0 to 3, and we help kids reach those developmental milestones. And then we also work with 3+ in the school system, providing OT, PT services, and clinical psychology services for evaluations. And so just knowing that you could reach out to us and, you know, move forward with potentially getting services or even just ask us questions, too, because we're
screening.
Here, to be a resource and give you strategies specifically for your child.
That's great. There's so much great stuff on offer in the military, and it's one of the reasons I like doing the podcast is really getting it out there, everything that's available. So it's good to know that what's available there.
And I think using your counselors, too, that are at your school, then also MFLAX, right? I feel like not enough people utilize them. And they're such wonderful professionals that are here to service our military children.
All right. So don't laugh. But what is an MFLAC? I don't know what that is.
So it's
Military Family Life Counselors. There
okay.
Yeah.
So,
yes. Military.
So
family.
What is it? But what do they do? Like,
so there are assigned MFLAC counselors to each school, maybe one or two in each school.
Okay. All right.
And they're either assigned to a specific grade level, right? And they're housed in the school. So a teacher or a school counselor, or a school psychologist, or the team, we call it the student support team, will say, hey, Johnny needs extra support. They're not providers. They're not clinicians. They're not the actual school psychologists or school counselors, but they're the extra support that they're here as an extra resource.
Got it.
Right. And some of them I've talked to, they are actually, their backgrounds are either psychologists, former teachers, social workers, you know, good background.
So people who are kind of used to working with kids.
Yes.
Awesome. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Like, there's so much stuff. It's hard to keep track of how much is available, you know? But really, really great stuff to know. So, yeah, maybe to wrap it up, let's just talk about, you know, managing expectations, right? As kids are, maybe they're, like you guys said, the new universal pre-K, or they're new high school students, right? In this new world, like managing expectations for what we should expect out of our kids as they're starting this new school journey.
Yeah. So first thing, whenever you have a major change, right, and you're adjusting to a new schedule, your kids are going to be tired.
Of course.
So they're going to come home and you're going to be so excited to ask them about their day and what they did and how much fun they had. And they might not be ready for that. They might need to decompress. They might need to take a nap. And
it was
so,
good.
Yeah.
It was good. Clothes.
Who did you hang out with?
I don't know. What'd you have for lunch?
Yeah.
I don't know.
I don't know.
Don't know.
Did you eat the bento box?
But having that grace for them as they adjust to that new routine is super duper important. I think also, kind of on the flip side of that is that you continue to try, though, right? That open communication. So maybe they don't want to talk about it right after school, but maybe before they go to bed at night, or maybe even the next morning, whatever works for your family. Just having that dialogue on like, hey, how are things going?
Yep.
And if they're younger, maybe just like checking in with their teacher every once in a while and seeing, you know, how things are going in the classroom, because it's hard when you're not there to really know how your child is participating and how they're doing academically. So just keeping that line of communication open.
And also, we are a community, Yokosuka, we are a big community here. And it's okay to reach out to other parents, you need to know the friends of your children as well. So just reach out. You know, we are a big community. We have good resources here. And it is okay. And it's okay to say, I am so stressed and I need help as well, you know, as a parent.
Yeah, because it could be a lot for parents, too, yeah. Right? 100%. Like, I know we're focusing on the children today, but, you know, it could be like a really emotional thing, mm-hmm. your kids starting school yeah. or starting high school or whatever mm-hmm. it is. And, you know, a lot of our families are moving into a completely yes, new environment.
BCS season. Right.
So just giving yourself that grace, yes. too, is super mm-hmm. important.
Mm-hmm. And it's okay to acknowledge that.
Yes. Yeah.
To remember that, yeah, we're people and our kids are people too, yeah. right?
little versions little of us, yeah.
Yes. Well, great. Hey, ladies, thank you so much for coming. I think this is a lot of really great information. All the kind of resources that we spoke about will be in the show notes. So if any listeners want to use any of those resources, they'll be there. And yeah, other than that, thanks again, both of you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. This is an experience.
Very yeah. Cool.
All right. And then, I hope we can have you all back. And to our listeners, take care and we'll see you next time.